everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. I saw some people from Romania. I saw some people from LA. There are some people here for the first time on Puremix Live in New York. We're in New York. We're in Flux Studios, where all the gear is strong, all the music is beautiful, and all the equipment is above average. Today, we're going to have an amazing departure from what we usually do, which means no snare drums will be hit. Instead, we're going to have a classical recital. And we're going to have a classical recital by Melody Fader & Co. This is Melody Fader, her actual real name. Melody Fader, you were supposed to be a rock star. You're not supposed to be a piano player.
I am a rock star.
Okay, there you go. And here we have part of the Co, Emilienne Gendron, who's going to play violin for us today. We're going to hear three pieces.
Yes.
What's the first piece?
The first piece is Sonata by Mozart for piano and violin.
I heard of Mozart.
Yeah, Mozart.
Yeah, good composer.
Very good. Yeah.
All right. So, and then second piece.
Second piece is Schumann, Robert Schumann, Sonata for violin and piano.
Okay.
And.
And then the third piece is Brahms.
Third piece is Brahms. Yes.
And then we're going to bring Andrea Lee later, who's going to play cello with us. Okay.
Yes.
So. Why did you choose those pieces? Why those three pieces?
Well, actually, I sometimes the choice, well, there's lots of reasons,
yeah.
But I just had a performance last night with a dance company, and we played the Mozart.
Well, that's a very good reason.
On that. So whenever I like to play things a lot because they get so much better when you have multiple opportunities to play them. So.
Okay. Great. So
the Mozart came because it was for dance.
Okay, beautiful.
Schumann.
Well, we've performed it a couple times this season.
Okay. Yeah, it's so beautiful.
Yeah.
And we just chose this piece together, right?
Yes. I think we had both played it before, and we knew that we would enjoy playing
it. A long time ago. Yeah.
And then the Brahms piece, which is fierce.
Oh yes, the Brahms. So that is. Something that we actually, Emily and I played it together on a concert in January, but it was a last minute fill-in piece because the singer on the program got sick and couldn't sing. So we were like, what can we do? It's exciting and beautiful. And we did that. And so we're bringing it back, just the first movement today.
Okay, that's beautiful. Okay, so I'm gonna shut up. I'm gonna go over there and you guys are gonna start.
Okay.
The first piece. And then you can just play the three pieces in a row. You can leave that on, we'll turn it off.
I'll take it off.
You'll take it off? Okay, great. So somebody back there is going to know that Melody is removing her microphone.
Should I take it off now?
Yeah. Just play the pieces. And you guys, feel free to applaud in between movements. You all know the cue. They're very good at the cues. All right, great. Wonderful. Have fun. I'll see you in a few minutes.
Thank you.
That was lovely, says the voice from the sky.
First Sonata. A minor, 3 movements.
Dark and stormy.
And a little bit crazy.
Yeah, just a little. Okay. Thank you.
Welcome, Andrea Lee, to the stage. So what's next, Melody?
Now we have the first movement of Brahms' C major piano trio.
Thank you.
Wow, wow, that was so awesome. That was so beautiful. Scusi. That was so, so, so nice. I want to stand real near you, okay. That way they can hear you through this one. Okay. That's awesome. So this is, do whatever you like, darling. This was amazing, this was amazing. You guys sound so beautiful, so, so beautiful. And there were people listening from Crimea, Bangladesh, Russia, England, basically all of Europe, some Australia, all over the world. Everybody all over the world was listening to this. It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. So this is the part where I geek out.
Okay.
So feel free to look bored. It's okay. So here's the things that may be interesting to you, though. So I decided to mic this in a non-traditional way for classical. For two reasons. A is because I have no idea how people mic for classical, because I don't make classical records. That's a very good reason. So I don't like to fake anything. And second, because I thought it would be interesting. So so I'll play you a little bit of the recording in a minute so you guys can hear how you sound. You must be tired. You've been playing and dancing the whole time. It's awesome. So yeah, please do sit. Make yourself comfortable. So, all right, so here's what I did. All we had in the room, total for everything, was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 mono microphones and 1 stereo microphone. On the piano, we had all Lauten Atlantises, and I did it Elton John style, meaning nice and close to the hammers and very present, so that we could get a more modern recording presence, like kind of what you would hear on a jazz record or on a pop record. Usually in classical recordings, they put the microphone somewhere around here. I had asked my friend Todd Whitelock, who's a badass at recording classical and Broadway to come, but he's too busy finishing the Christian McBride record. So I said, okay, you can stay home for that. And then I have another microphone at the bottom over there, just at the cross of the frame, that helps me create a little bit of depth in the middle. So I have this panned about, I would say 30-70 like this. I'll give you the exact numbers when we go back into the control room. And this is dead center. And there's probably 70% of this and 30% of that. And that's the piano sound. And then for the strings, for the violin, and for the cello, I have a Lauten Audio Eden, which is a tube microphone. These are FETs. This is a tube. The reason why I chose this is because you may have noticed that she moves a lot, right? So Andrea doesn't move that much because she's sitting. But the violin's moved a lot. So I didn't want to compress. I wanted to flow. When I heard the music yesterday, I came yesterday and they were rehearsing here, I was like, oh, goodness gracious. Like the dynamic range of this stuff is probably 10 times when we get for dynamic range for pop records or for jazz records. Even jazz records are compressed these days. So I basically have almost no compression on this. I definitely have no compression on any of the instruments. All the instruments are just mic'd raw, gain, no EQ, no compression. There's just a little compressor on the whole mix to make sure that I don't blow up your ears over there on the other side of the stream. That's all. So this is wide open through the console. I'll show you the settings in a minute. And it's in cardio, and it's in gentle. And all the microphones are in gentle, which is a darker, more vintage sounding version sound of these microphones. Both the Atlantis and the Eden have three different ways to voice the microphone, and I voice these three in gentle, and I voice this one in gentle, and I voice the cello one in forward. Because where Andrea is sitting, I pick up a lot of the bottom of the piano, and I wanted to be able to keep definition on the cello so I could hear everything she does. And to do that, I put that microphone in forward. So the thing that's really interesting is first I made a mistake. I did not listen to the beginning of every piece. And the one thing I didn't do is at the end of our sound check, I did not listen to the beginning of the first piece, which is abject failure. Because what I did not know is that the beginning of the first piece was a fierce, pedal-heavy piece on the piano. And so I ended up with a lot of pedal noise on the first 30, 40 bars. And then I jumped on my console and high-passed the piano to get rid of the pedal noise. So that was failure number one on my hand. I'm a professional. Don't try this at home, folks. Thank you. And then the second thing I did not expect, well, I expected it, but I didn't expect it to this extent, is that the difference in writing between the Mozart piece and the Schumann piece and the Brahms piece is that over the course of the 40 minutes, from piece to piece, the piano got darker and darker and darker and darker. The way the Mozart piece, it's the same player with the same microphones placed in the exact same spot on the same piano with the same preamps, everything exactly the same. I changed nothing. The difference in tone in the piano between the Mozart, the Schumann, and the Brahms is that it went bright and clear like a bell, sort of kind of moody, and then dark as hell. And that's in the writing with the same microphone, same everything. Isn't that awesome? That's just beautiful. So balancing the violin and the piano changed over time. So on the first piece, I had to push the violin. On the second piece, the violin started to overpower the piano because of the writing, not because of the miking. I changed no settings. That's awesome. So now that I've had, it's rare to hear these kind of pieces played together, recorded at the same time. And so now I understand why those records sound the way they do. It's because maybe more time should be spent on miking per piece. To get the most out of the instrument per piece. So that was an interesting thing that happened. And so I had to adjust the level of the violin and then the violin and the cello, depending on the movement, a little bit. Otherwise, they would either overpower the piano or the piano would overpower the strings. But in the room, the balance was flawless, right? In the room, the balance was flawless. So the way it comes across cables and the way it comes across in your ears is completely different and depends on the writing. I find that really pretty badass, which is a technical term. So these are these microphones. And then over there in the back, I have a Neumann SM2, which is a stereo microphone from the late 50s. which is a tube stereo microphone. And I'm using that to create depth. So the balance set is I started with the piano. And then to match the picture, I panned the violin and the cello a little bit, respectively, to what you see on the picture. Of course, someone reversed left and right on the stream because that was a lot of fun. But somebody said, hey, why am I hearing the violin on the left? Because someone failed at something. So we reversed that rapidly. And then I used the room to create depth. So now I'm going to abandon you guys, and then we're going to go geek out in the control room. I'll be back in a few minutes. All right. This is the part where we should have had champagne. Yeah. Oh, another tragic failure. All right, make a note for the next broadcast. Let's move to the control room. I'll be back in 5 minutes. Sit tight, people. Maybe 7 minutes. Keep going. No, keep going. Steve, you coming? This is John.
Hey, everybody.
John, make sure that you can hear what's going on. All right. So, are we live? All right. So, what's going on here? Very simple patch bay. You notice that there's not as much spaghetti as usual. And so this is the three piano channels. You'll notice that on the three piano channels, all I have is high passes. And then on the left and right, when we got to the Schumann and to the Brahms, I opened the top a little bit so we could hear all that flow, that incredible movement a little more. And then you could see that the center is about, you know, two-thirds down. Violin, cello, just gain, high pass at 27 hertz, no EQ, nothing, just a high pass to get rid of the room rumble. And then the room is way down here. Same thing, high pass at 27, a little bit of gain. Now here's the trick. I personally, I really don't like when I hear really dry, when the room is very distinguishable and very small around instruments like this. I just don't like it. It's personal taste. And so I like when you can't tell there's a room or it feels ample. And to do so, what I did is I sent the room to a Bricasti reverb, M7, on the hall setting. I used a standard medium hall. It's not very important because it's pretty quiet. And I just returned that. And I also sent the violin and a little bit of the piano and a little bit of the cello to my EMT 140, my real EMT 140 plate. So the space that you hear around the instruments is not this room. This room is too small to have that space, but it felt natural to me. At least it felt natural here. And it's created by a blend of the EMT on the direct instruments and the Bricasti to transform my room mic into bigger room mics. And I could choose the size of the room here. So the busier and the broodier it got, the less room I put in. And then the clearer and the more bell-like. So for the Mozart, there was a little more room. And then the so this is all done analog. And then the output of the desk, this master fader right here, is being sent to a dangerous compressor. And that is, as I said a minute ago, it's just there to make sure that I don't blow your D2A converters or that I don't explode our converters on the way to you. And it's on 1.4.1, everything's automatic on it. And there's about, it was on average at 1 to 2 dBs of compression, never more. The thing about the compressor is that even if it were this compressor, the dangerous compressor, even with 5, 6, 7, 10 dBs of compression, you don't hear it. So as long as the time constants are good, it's basically somebody riding a fader, except it's automatic, which is nice. And then after this, for a little bit of color, as somebody wrote on the broadcast, it's classical music, it should feel vintage. I put my Neumann. I have a pair of Neumann PEAs, but I put them on flat. I just wanted to go through extra transformers just for a little bit of color. And I love the way it's, I tried EQing it, I tried giving it a little bit of high end, and I tried giving it a little bit of low end, and both felt like I could hear right away that it felt processed, which is the opposite of what I wanted. I wanted it to be as close to what you heard in the room with extra sauce as possible. And then that goes to you, and that's it. This is as pure as it gets. And you'd think that because there's not that much stuff, it should be easy. But it wasn't that easy. Start the recording. It really wasn't that easy. Because you move the fader this much, and you can hear it from the moon. So everything is so incredibly clear and so incredibly precise and unprocessed that any movement is heard. So it was kind of like a really difficult to make decisions. And all this was monitored on these new Focal shapes, which we've been testing for months. We've been putting stickers on the logo so that nobody knows what they were. These are really wonderful. These are the 50s. And I would say it's probably the most universally liked speaker that I've ever put anywhere. Everybody who listens to them likes them. So I think Focal is going to do very well with those. I think they're actually official now. So that's why I'm allowed to talk about them. I don't know that they're selling, but they're official. Yeah. They are selling. Okay, they are selling. I like the speaker. It's good. What else? That's it. I think this is it for our recital. Now I'm going to invite the musicians in the control room. Maybe I'm going to send somebody to get some champagne, and then I'm going to play them what they just played, and I'm going to see how they feel about this kind of recording for their music, because I'm pretty sure they never heard anything quite with that color on this kind of music. These guys are so unbelievably good. I feel very lucky and fortunate that they agreed to play for us today. So that's it for today. Thanks so much for watching PureMix.live, where, as I said earlier, all the gear is strong, all the music is beautiful, and all the engineers are above average. Et voilà. Ciao.